reflecting on the death of Jesus on the cross, but also on a positive note, his last seven sayings on the cross and how they can help us live our lives in a very practical way. So let's start with talking about Jesus' whole life story in our first hymn, One Day When Heaven Was Filled With His Praises. It's a great hymn, isn't it? Goes through the whole life of Jesus and in the future. We're going to have our first reading, which is Roger's coming to read. It's Mark 15, verses 33 to 44.
Mark 15, verse 33, the death of Jesus. At the sixth hour, the darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard him, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." One man ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, and put it on a stick and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two, from top to bottom. And when the centurion, who stood there in front of Jesus, heard his cry and saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph and Salome. In Galilee, these women had followed him and cared for his needs. Many other women who had come up with him to Jerusalem were also there. It was preparation day, that is, the day before the Sabbath. So as evening approached, Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council who was himself waiting for the kingdom of God, went boldly to Pilate and asked for Jesus' body. Pilate was surprised to hear that he was already dead. Summoning the centurion, he asked him if Jesus had already died. When he learned from the centurion that it was so, he gave the body to Joseph. So Joseph bought some linen cloth, took down the body, wrapped it in the linen, placed it in a tomb cut out of rock. Then he rolled a stone against the entrance of the tomb.
Thank you. Thank you, Roger. I'm going to sing our second hymn, "Who, O Lord, Can Save Themselves?"
Thank you.
Amen to that. Can I have our second reading? Andy's going to come and read from Luke 23, verses 32 to 46.
Two men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. When they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him along with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they divided up his clothes by casting lots. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, he saved others, let him save himself. If he is the Christ of God, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up, mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was a written notice above him which read, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God," he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly for what we are getting and for what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said to Jesus, "Remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise." Jesus' death. It was now the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. For the sun stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn into two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. Amen.
Thank you, Andy. We're going to have a time of open prayer this morning. I thought it'd be really good to have a time of adoration, praising God for Jesus' sacrifice. And so just a time of open prayer, and then I'll finish in prayer.
Mm-hmm. Amen. We thank you, God, for the sacrifice you made. It's bittersweet. You suffered and suffered badly at the hands of the Romans and the Jewish leaders at the time. But we also know that through this, our sins are forgiven. So we thank you for all that you went through. Amen.
Amen. Lord, we thank you for that amazing grace.
Yeah.
And saved a wretch like me. And we thank you that we can do nothing of ourselves except rest in on the finished work of the Lord Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, that he has done it all. It's all of Christ and none of us. We thank you, Lord, that you look down upon a sinful world. You love the world and you sought and saved so many people. So many who came to the foot of the cross where we must all go. To find you, we must go and confess our sins and you must forgive us our sins. You might forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We have nothing to offer but ourselves, Lord. We have no good works. We have nothing that would accomplish the salvation that we so needed. The complete salvation. All in Christ. In Christ is found a resting place. Not in a creed or anything else. I found the resting place. We thank you for that. We all need that, Lord. We all need peace in a troubled world. We all need peace for our mentality, for our minds. And so often, Lord, we see troubled souls. And we pray, Lord, for those that have been mentioned this morning. We ask, Lord, that you would touch their hearts. And their minds so needed that we may have the peace of God that passes all understanding.
Yeah.
Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Lord God, we thank you that you sent your Son to earth to live among the Jewish nation and to become their Messiah. But more than that, your kingdom to earth, and it meant that everyone in the whole world could now enter your kingdom. You didn't have to be Jewish to do it.
No.
All Gentiles, that's everyone else in the world, given that opportunity to be your children and to be united with you, their Creator, and that's a wonderful thing. All of us sitting here, we're not part of the Jewish nation, but we're part of your kingdom. We're your children, and we thank you for that wonderful gift that you gave to us, far beyond what was imagined by those people back then in Israel. That you had a greater plan, you had a plan for the whole world, and we thank you that we can come today and stand before you as a God and worship you, and there's no barriers. The curtain was rent in two.
Yeah.
We were able to move into your presence. That was a symbol of what it meant, and we see it in reality today. Amen.
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 Lord Jesus, we thank you for your love. It was your love that submitted to beatings and torture, and ultimately being nailed to the cross. It was your love and not thinking of yourself, that spoke out to the thief who asked that he might be with the Lord, be with the Lord. And Jesus, you said, this day you will be with me in paradise. What a thing, Lord. The thief wasn't expecting that.
Mm.
He was just expecting death and whatever he believed came after death. But Lord, you reassured him, even while you were dying on the cross. And Lord, you do that now from glory. You want us all to know and enjoy your love and forgiveness from whatever we've done. And you don't say it's okay, but Lord, there's no punishment. And you bring us to your kingdom.
Yeah.
You're there waiting for each one of us when it's our time. And Lord, we just praise you that this is only possible because of what happened on that day so long ago. And Lord, we will never fully appreciate what you did for us until we see you face to face. But we do thank you from the bottom of your heart, our hearts, that you made that possible. Amen.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you for all that you did for us. Lord, we just praise your name. And Lord, we pray that for this Easter time, that those in our families that don't know you, Lord, will come to realise that Easter isn't just about fluffy chicks and eggs. Lord, we just pray that they will come to know that you came and sacrificed yourself for us, Lord. To ask it in your name.
Amen.
So, dear Lord, we do thank you for this time of prayer. As we come to your word, I pray that you would infuse me with the Holy Spirit. I thank you for last night and remembrance of what you went through for this fateful day. And it is love that kept you on the cross. Those that were mocking were so wrong. You could have got down from that cross at any time, but love kept you there. Thank you for your love, Lord. Mm-hmm. And as we open the scriptures in a minute, I pray that you will give us an insight into what the cross really means for us today in very practical means and ways. So help me, dear Lord, in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Richard, would you like to say a prayer?
Yes, of course.
I pray for Chess Fraser. No.
Okay. Pray for
Chess Fraser.
Has it gone wrong?
No.
He just wants one. That's fine.
That's good. You can pray for anything.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's fine. No, that's good. That's what Roger was saying there. We can come freely to the throne of graces if you like. In the past, you had to go through all sorts of ceremonies. Now we can come and ask for small things and large things.
Yeah.
That's quite large, actually.
Yeah.
Chess Fraser. Good, thank you. Thank you for sharing that with us. Okay, we're going to sing a third hymn, and then Jan's going to come and read John 19, verses 25 to 30. So we're going to sing Beneath the Cross of Jesus, and then hopefully we will be beneath the cross.
Thank you.
So the last reading is John 19, verses 25 to 30. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother, his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that all was now completed, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it, put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant, and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Thank you. Thank you, Jan. The last words of people are quite important, aren't they? And quite incredible sometimes. So I was looking at some of the last words of people. And the first one is from a very famous artist, song artist called Bob Marley. To his son, he said, "Money can't buy life." That's very true, isn't it? And he was defiant to the end. And Karl Marx's last words were, "The last words are for fools who haven't said enough." Maybe he learnt the lesson after that. And then there's this: "The bitterest tears shed over graves are for the words left unsaid and the deeds left undone." This was from a very not a well-known person, but it was from Beecher Stave, who was an anti-slave campaigner, best known for the book Uncle Tom's Cabin. Winston Churchill, in his own amusing way, his last words were, "I'm bored with it all." And then he died. And very telling is the words of Queen Elizabeth. Her last words were, "All my possessions for a moment of time." Then I'm going to finish this quotes time by quoting something that you'll find very inspiring and very surprising. "I have decided that my death should be very precious. I really want to use it. I'd like my death to be as interesting as my life has been and will be." Could have been written by Jesus, or said by Jesus, but it was said by David Bowie. The last words of Jesus were not just any throwaway words. They were very important. And we're going to look at these last words of Jesus, but not just going to look at them, we're going to understand, hopefully, what they mean to us now, in this day and age, 2,000 years on. So we're going to start in Mark's Gospel. We're not going to do it chronologically. We're going to start in Mark's Gospel, and we look at verses 33 to 34 for the first saying. "At noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And at 3 p.m, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?'" I always feel like I could imagine myself there. There's 3 hours of darkness when God put all the sins of the world on his son. "He that knew no sin was made sin," the Bible says. It was horrific. But God's love and mercy was such greatness. It's so great that he made darkness come upon the land that was felt. Darkness and silence. Maybe there was a little murmuring. What is this? And suddenly, this cry rents from the cross. Jesus knew this was going to happen. Listen to his words in the Garden of Gethsemane. "Abba, Father," he said. That's Daddy, Father. "If it is any way possible for you to take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will." Jesus paid the ultimate penalty for us so that we don't have to suffer hell. But the sad thing is, if we don't take that personal invitation to come unto him and cast all our burdens upon him, if we don't come to him, we won't get the benefits of this. It will be outside of us. But it's there for us. And he still has his hands wide open, saying, "Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. I will give you life and life more abundant." And it all came from this perfect sacrifice. 2 Corinthians 5:21, "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that he might become righteousness of God." And that's the practical thing today is, it's no good knowing the story. It's no good saying it's a good story of a man that has lived a life that is perfect and die in the sacrifice if you don't take that up personally. An exchange, an atonement, suffered hell so that we don't need to. What a cry of dereliction that must have been. I would suggest that is the most horrific cry in all humanity. Someone who had been with his Father and the Holy Spirit in all eternity was suddenly rent away because he was made sin, because God could not look on sin. I know there's others that say, how can this be? But if you think about this, a Trinity is three separate persons working within the Godhead. So in incarnation, it was Jesus that was the seed that was put by the Holy Spirit in Mary. So it's not unique, but it is absolutely incredible. So that's the first saying that will give us hope. But then we move on to Luke 23, which Andy read to us. And we read this in 32 to 34. "The two men, other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. They came to the place called the Skull. They crucified him there along with the criminals, one on his right and one on the left. And Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing.' And they divided up his clothes by casting lots." Just think of that. Just think of that. Just pause and think of that. He's asking for his Father to forgive those people who had beaten him, had put a crown of thorns on him, that had spat on him, that had slapped him, that had sneered at him. What a forgiving God we've got. What a merciful God we've got. God opened up a way of salvation through Jesus' sacrifice. He didn't lay that upon them. But what he does lay upon people is if they refuse that salvation. That is the one sin that God will never forgive, when we refuse the sacrifice of Jesus. But that real practical thing out of there is forgiveness, isn't it? And if we think of our own lives, someone who has done us real harm, what is our response? We want to do them harm. Jesus showed the way forward. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." Forgive their ignorance. Doesn't that give us hope? And slightly off the track, doesn't that give us hope for those that have died without knowing about Christ? That have never known about the Lord Jesus Christ? God is a just God. Just think about that. If we're Christians, if we are those that believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, we all played a part in putting Jesus to death. The gospel, the good news, is that God is a gracious and forgiving God. And he gives us new life through his Son. Amazing, isn't it? And he also gave us that practical advice, even when he was dying, to forgive others. What a saviour. What a man. What a God. But then there's this in this section, excuse me, verses 35 to 43. The people stood watching, and the rulers even sneered at him. They said, "He saved others, let him save himself, if he is God's Messiah, the chosen one." The soldiers also came up and mocked him. They offered him wine vinegar and said, "If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself." There was written a notice above him which read, "This is the king of the Jews." One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God," he said, "since you're under the same sentence? We are punished justly for what we're getting, what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." Jesus answered him, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Dave, can you play that clip now, please?
Without the preaching of the cross, without preaching the cross to ourselves all day and every day, we will very, very quickly revert to faith plus works as the ground of our salvation. So that to go to the old Fort Lauderdale question, if you were to die tonight and you were getting entry into heaven, what would you say? If you answer that, and if I answer it in the first person, we've immediately gone wrong. Because I believed, because I have faith, because I am this, because I am continuing. Loved ones, the only proper answer is in the third person, because he. And think about the thief on the cross. And what an immense, I can't wait to find that fellow one day to ask him, how did that shake out for you? Because you were cussing the guy out with your friend. You'd never been in a Bible study. You never got baptized. You didn't know a thing about church membership. And yet, you made it. You made it. How did you make it? That's what the angel must have said, you know, like, what are you doing here? Well, I don't know. What do you mean you don't know? Well, because I don't know. Well, you know, excuse me, let me get my supervisor. They go get the supervisor in. So, we're just a few questions for you. First of all, are you clear on the doctrine of justification by faith? The guy said, "I never heard of it in my life." And what about, let's just go to the doctrine of Scripture immediately. This guy's just staring. And eventually, in frustration, he says, on what basis are you here?" And he said, "The man on the middle cross said, I can come." Now, that is the only answer. That is the only answer. And if I don't preach the gospel to myself all day and every day, then I will find myself beginning to trust myself, trust my experience, which is part of my fallenness as a man. If I take my eyes off the cross, I can then give only lip service to its efficacy, while at the same time living as if my salvation depends upon me. And as soon as you go there, it will lead you either to abject despair or a horrible kind of arrogance. And it is only the cross of Christ that deals both with the dreadful depths of despair and the pretentious arrogance of the pride of man that says, you know, I can figure this out and I'm doing wonderfully well. No, because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. That's why Luther says most of your Christian life is outside of you, in this sense, that we know that we're not saved by good works. We're not saved as a result of our professions, but we're saved as a result of what Christ has achieved.
You see what he's saying there? It's a great, great piece from Alistair Begg. He's saying you don't need to know all these things. The gospel is that you rely on the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not saying it's bad to know all these things. And of course, as you grow as a Christian, you need to know all these things. And it's good to know these things. I remember a story from another great man, Robert Murray McShane. He was a big preacher in Scotland. He was a very successful preacher in Scotland in the 1800s. And someone came to him as a candidate for baptism. She'd been saved. She was 7 years old. And she came up in front of the deacons. And they were very solemn people. And they said, "Little girl, are you a bit young for this?" Do you know, her reply was fantastic. She said, "Sirs, with all due respect, I'm not too young to die." And that's the point, isn't it? Didn't have to live all these lives. And that gives us hope. The man on the middle cross was saved by asking God to forgive him, Jesus to forgive him, and to be with him in paradise. His true forgiveness, his heartfelt repentance was seen by God. And his request was given. He didn't have to go to Bible school. He didn't even read to anything. He needed to make that decision for Christ, as it were. But as Alistair was saying, it was all of Jesus. He couldn't do it. He's on the cross. He couldn't do any good works. Doesn't that give us great hope? Maybe it doesn't. It does give us great hope, because there, in a nutshell, is the gospel. The free salvation of God through the Lord Jesus Christ, through his sacrifice. Romans 10 verse 9, this glorious piece from Paul. "If you declare with your mouth, Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead, and go to Bible college," no, it doesn't say that, "you will be saved." Wow, what a gospel. What an encouragement for us. What an encouragement. So Jesus was on the cross, dying there in pain. He didn't say to the man in the middle, "Look, I've got enough pains and problems on my own." He was there reaching out, and he'll reach out to anyone who truly, truly calls to him. And that, brothers and sisters, should encourage us to carry on. And we carry on to the next saying. "It was now about noon, and darkness fell over the whole land until 3 p.m, for the sun stopped shining and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, 'Father, into your hands I commit my spirit.' When he had said this, he breathed his last." Father, into your hands I've committed my spirit. This shows that Jesus was indeed God. He couldn't die on the cross. There was no way he could die on the cross unless he gave up his life. Have you missed that sometimes when reading that? God gave up his life for us so that we may have a new life in him, a new way of coming to him. In Hebrews 12, verses 1 to 3, the writer of the Hebrews, whoever that may be, said, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by a great crowd of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith, for the joy set before him, that he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you may that you may not grow weary and lose heart." Don't give up your race, he's saying. Remember what Jesus did for you. He gave up his whole life for you. So why don't you just give up a little time for him? This is the practical thing. And we've all been there, haven't we? We haven't got time to read the Bible. We haven't got time to do this. Let's think back. Maybe Jesus could have said, "I don't want to go through with this. I haven't got time for you." Never said that in his ministry. Even when the little children came to him, he said to his disciples, "Don't restrict them. Bring them to me." He's always got time for him, and we should always have time for Jesus. We should always make time for worshiping him, coming to him, praying to him, having communication with him. Don't give up, because Jesus has never gave up. He gave his life for us. He gave up his very being for us. And then last we look at John's Gospel, the bit that Jan read. John 19. My voice lasts. I'm sure it will. John 19, verses 25 to 30. And verses 25 to 27 says this. "Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleos, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved, which was John, standing nearby, he said to her, 'Woman, here is your son.' And to the disciple, 'Here is your mother.' From that time on, this disciple took her into his home." What an amazing thing to do. The pain, the suffering that Jesus was on the cross, the physical suffering, the spiritual suffering. And yet, he looked and saw someone in need and he cared for them. Caring for those he loved, even when he was suffering. No wonder Paul burst forth in Ephesians 3, verses 14 to 20. This wonderful, wonderful piece here in Ephesians. Paul has looked in these chapters before at Christ, us being made alive in Christ, and the marvellous, God's marvellous plan for us and for the Gentiles and for the Jews. And then he comes to this part in Ephesians 3, verses 14 to 20. "For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you have been rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide, long, high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God." "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within him. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus, for all generations, forever and ever. Amen. You can almost hear him welling up with praise and love. There's a little boy that comes to Messi called Jude. He's one of Brenda Barnes' great-grandchildren. And he's only three. I think he's three. But he loves singing, "How wide is the ocean? How high is the heaven above? How deep is the Saviour's love?" And he loves singing it. And actually that is good, because he's understanding something. And he actually got up, apparently, in one of the, I can't remember where it was, a garden centre or something, and started singing it. That's great, isn't it? But he's got hold of that, and he loves it. And we should get hold of it. Look at it in these verses. God's love for the Lord Jesus Christ, that in his own agony, he was able to look down and care for others. So my prayer for us as a family here at Chailey is that we're always caring, that we're always looking after each other as an example from Jesus on the cross. I fear we will fail to get to his standards, but I feel we should really try because of the love that he has shown us. Then verse 28 in John's Gospel. Jesus says these words, "I am thirsty." Knowing that scripture may be fulfilled, he said, "I am thirsty." He was conscious that he needed to fulfill all the scriptures before he died. But there was a second, two reasons, I think. Maybe he was thinking of Psalm 69, verse 21b, "For my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink." He was saying, "Look, what I'm doing now was written centuries before. It is part of God's plan. It was set in place long before now." He was saying, "Can't you see that? Can you not see how I'm fulfilling all these things?" But also it was a strong desire, spiritual desire, thirsting for God. Psalm 42 verse 2 says, "My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. Whom can I go and meet with God?" In other words, his desire is to be with his Father. I thirst for my Father. I want to be with him. But what's that got to do with us? Well, let's look just one verse back in Psalm 42. "As the deer pants for streams of water, so my soul pants for you, my God." A deer who is thirsty, or any animal that's thirsty, will look for water. Even us, we look for water. We have water. We drink it and we're refreshed. That should be our desire. A desire for God. It should come from our soul, the very being. Like Jesus. We need to have an attitude of Paul in Philippians 1:21. In the Amplified Bible, it says, "For me to live is Christ. He is my source of joy, my reason to live. And to die is gain, for I will be with him in eternity." What on earth could the people do to Paul to stop him? They could say to him, "Paul, if you don't stop preaching the gospel, we're going to put you to death." He'd say, "Good, I'll be with God." And they said, "Well, okay, we won't do that then." And he said, "Well, that's good, because I can now live for Christ and tell people about it." They couldn't do anything for him or to him. And it's the same with us. If we're alive, we're doing it to glorify God. If we die, it is gain. And that's why at the funeral of someone that we know is a Christian, it is a sad occasion, but it is also tainted with joy, because we know that we're with the Lord in glory. Remember the thief on the cross? "Today you will be with me in paradise." So that's the joy that we have. That's the thirst that we should have for God. Which leads us to the final saying in verse 4-30. In John 19, verse 30. When he had received the drink, Jesus said in a loud voice, "It is finished." And with that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Significant. Because up until that point, it was our complicated systems of sacrifice. Look, if you go through the Old Testament, you can see how complicated it is. There's several books, several chapters, chapter after chapter after chapter of what sacrifices are needed to appease God. It was all looking forward to this one sacrifice in Jesus, the perfect sacrifice. The sacrifice that was given, that said in Hebrews, that he then, when it's sacrificed, sat down at the right hand of God. That means it's finished. No more. No need. No need for frequent sacrifices. What was interesting is that the word finished is the same as the word paid in full in Greek. Paid in full. It's like having your mortgage written off, your debts written off, paid in full. Jesus came to finish paying full God's work of salvation. Remember at the beginning of his ministry, he said, "The kingdom of heaven is at hand." And now he says, "It is finished." All the complex sacrificial systems was no long needed. Now you can freely approach God because of what Jesus did for us. Hebrews 4 verse 16, "Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in times of need." So those who are the whosoever of John 3:16, whosoever cometh unto me, can enjoy salvation eternally with God and escape the penalty that comes from sin. But there's another part to this. It is the finished work of Christ. And I was speaking to my fellow elder the other day, and he was saying that this cross is interesting. It reminds him that sometimes we have problems in our life, and we bring it to the cross of God, as we do, and we put our petitions before God, and we say, "Lord, these are our problems. This is what we've got in our life." And then as we get off, as it were, from our knees, we take those problems and we take them back with ourselves. Brothers and sisters, it is finished. So leave your problems at the foot of the cross. Anyone heard of Pilgrim's Progress? I'm sure you have. And in it, in this analogy that was written, I know it was a long time back in 1500s. Yes, it was 1500s. But John Bunyan is talking about a Christian who's going through his life and he's got this burden on his back, burden of sin. And this person has set out and then he comes to the base of the cross. And this burden of sin rolls down into the, from the hill of Calvary, straight into the open sepulchre, and the sepulchre shuts, and he sees it no more. And that's what we are to God. When he looks at us, he doesn't see our sins. God said that he will put the sins as far as the east is from the west. I did it the wrong way, but you know what I mean. There is no sins because he looks at us. And it's not as though he is turning a blind eye. He's looking at us and seeing the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is finished. It's complete. We need to come to him. We need to confess our sins. We need to bring our problems before him and lay them at the cross and move away. We tend to take them up again. And I feel that God must shake his head and say, "Dear brother, dear child, I've already forgiven you for that. Why are you bringing again?" So summing up, it shows us Jesus' love, determination, the length that God goes through to restore a relationship to him. But it's more than this. In his last words, he has shown that we need to forgive, we need to endure to the end, to have compassion and kindness. These are all lessons that he gave from the cross while he's in pain. But also we know that the story doesn't end there with his cross, with his death on the cross. So I'd like to invite each one of you to come back. I'm afraid we won't be, we're on holiday. Come back on Sunday to hear the triumphant end of this story. But as we finish, let's finish by saying, it is finished in Christ. Amen. Dear God, we thank you for these passages and your last seven sayings on the cross. Thank you that you were concerned for us to the very end. Thank you for the free salvation that you gave. And thank you for so much that you are doing for us and have done for us. But above all, that we may remember that it is finished, it is a complete work in you. In Jesus' name. Amen. Afterwards, we have got some hot cross buns. And before we go, I think Janice has got something to say as well. But we're going to have a final hymn, When I Stand Before Your Throne.
Stand before your throne, dressed in glory not my own. What a joy I'll sing of on that day. No more tears or broken dreams, forgotten is the minor key. Everything as it was meant to be. And we will worship. Forever in your presence, we will sing. We will worship you. An endless hallelujah to the King. Thank you. And we will worship, worship forever in your presence. We will sing, sing. We will worship, worship you. An endless hallelujah to the King.
What is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory for ever and ever. Amen. Janice, you've got something to say to us, I think.
Some of you may know already that there's a group of Christians who go to a church on an estate called Wintershall up near Guildford. And every Christmas they perform a nativity play in the barn up there several days in a row at night. And now they are ready to go and perform a play about what we just heard about, what Jesus did for us, his life just before Easter and up to after the resurrection. And they do it not on a stage. They come from different bits round Trafalgar Square as if by magic. They perform this play very close to crowds and crowds of people who are there. It starts at 12. And on Facebook, there's little slips of paper at the back. It's going to be on Facebook, live streamed at 12, and then again shown at 3 o'clock or 3:15, performed in London. And you can see this live stream yourself through Facebook. So if you just want the details of that, they're on little strips of paper at the back. But it is very real.
Yeah.
They wear very colourful clothes, I have to say. It's not sort of white and grey and black, in very colourful clothes. And these are believers who want everyone to know. And there's people from all nations, of, you can imagine, in London. And it's free, and people just come and they sit around. And yeah, it's quite an experience. So if you want to enjoy that again, the, sort of in the flesh this afternoon, it's live streamed on Facebook, so details at the back. I'll make sure they're in a prominent place.
Thank you,
God bless.
It's really worth seeing it myself. It's really worth going, and we're sure as well. We've been there, haven't we? Where they've got this big field up in Guildford, and they reenact the whole life of Jesus. It's really worth going to see. Thank you. Please do stay behind and have some fellowship with us and some hot cross buns. Got fancy ones.